Hello and welcome to the latest edition of CSTEP podcasts. The title of today's podcast is India's Shale Gas Potential, and it is being presented by Murali Ramakrishnan. Murali Ramakrishnan is currently pursuing his master's in public policy at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, National University of Singapore. In 2008, he graduated with a Bachelor of Engineering in Computer Science from the Anna University in Chennai. In 2009, he joined CSTEP and worked on a variety of projects until 2013. Post his work experience at CSTEP, he enrolled as a student of public policy at the National University of Singapore. As a senior research engineer at CSTEP, he worked extensively on topics pertaining to energy efficiency across energy-intensive industries using techno-economic models. He also participated in conducting a feasibility assessment of deploying solar lanterns across villages in India, aiming to reduce the usage of kerosene lanterns. What is shale gas, and who are the major producers of shale gas in the world today?
Shale gas is a form of natural gas trapped within the shale formation. Shales are ideally the sedimentary rocks which are rich in natural gas and petroleum per se. Typically, natural gas deposits are present in various forms of sedimentary rocks. So, from the history we know that sandstones, limestones are primarily sought after when it comes to sedimentary rocks. And these are primarily sought after simply because of its so-called high permeability status. And this clearly brings us a new challenge where shale gas is considered to be the most lower most permeability when it comes to extracting these resources. And talking about permeability, it is directly proportional to the amount of cost you invest in and the complexity of the technology per se. So I think these are all some of the factors that drives which country clearly, you know, goes for it and which country does not adopt it. And going by this series of questions, you can ideally think that, you know, from these challenges, you have Western countries which have primarily been chief R&D expert per se. And clearly, US and Canada are by far hands down, they have produced enough so far that they can be quoted as the primary producers of it. Alright, when it comes to outside the North American continent, you have once again, you have China because of its sheer size and the ability to do something different. So they have invested and they have reaped benefits from this technology. And once again, so these are all some of the what you call achievements in this industry, which also asks you a question why, you know, India is sort of 10 or 15 years behind this whole technology. And rightfully, coal has been the most dominant factor in India's energy mix. And we have so far, although there are other renewable energy resources like solar and wind slowly catching up, I mean, one could ideally argue from the fact that coal will be the dominant resource for the next 15, 20 years at least. In fact, both in China and in India.
So you bring in India into the picture, and I have to ask, what role could shale gas play in India's energy mix?
So, as suggested, so coal is by far the biggest resource in India's energy mix. And you have other small players like coal, nuclear, and you have wind, solar, biomass, and there are other host of what you call mix, small baskets which do contribute to our energy mix, but by not to the extent of what coal has done so far. To begin with, there are six basins identified, which could be Cambay, and then Assam Arakan, and then Gondwana, Krishna Godavari, Kaveri, and Indo-Gangetic Plain. These are the six basins identified with rich shale rocks. Now, an estimated amount of 527 trillion cubic feet reserves was identified by one of the report. And the other report clearly stated that 60 trillion cubic feet is the amount of recoverable resources. So now you have the two different understanding here, which is available reserves and you have recoverable resource. Available resource perhaps could be of any order, but then how much of it can be recovered? that picture comes in, and that is exactly why the first phase of this particular extraction process has been given to two of the state-owned companies. So one being ONGC and the other one being OIL. And ONGC and OIL has its own history when it comes to extraction of these fossil fuels. So they are by far two biggest clients, or per se actors in this case, who has proven enough that they have the ability to extract, and they have the technology, or they can adopt to these technologies and they can make use of it. Now, from the shale gas context, these state companies has been allotted with 175 blocks to begin with, and these 175 blocks accumulates to that 60 trillion cubic feet, which I was inferring to previously, which is supposed to be the lowermost number. Now, these 175 blocks is a comprisal of, you have three phases. Now, you have three phases, and three phases that has followed for extracting the resources. And ONGC has been allotted with, I guess, three quarter of the blocks, and one fourth of the block has been given to OIL because of its statutory power. And initially, even that first phase is once again subdivided into three phases, where the first phase is for about five blocks. And when I mean five blocks, so these blocks are identified zones where they drill wells, and each well has certain potential. So when you drill in the well, there are two types of technologies which are primarily used to extract shale gas. One is hydraulic fracturing and the other one is horizontal drilling. Hydraulic fracturing and horizontal drilling are pretty much identical technologies. However, one, hydraulic fracturing has been in the business for the last six decades, while horizontal drilling is slowly catching up when it comes to extraction of shale gas. And one can always ask, why not privatization now? So in this case, both the state-owned companies, and Reliance have proven enough why they should be in the market. At this juncture, I would like to quote that Reliance Industries, RIL, they have already invested in a couple of blocks in the US, and they have reaped benefits. In fact, between 2011 and 2012, they quoted that their investment has doubled. Their profit has doubled from this resource because of its potential. So you can clearly argue from the fact that financial constraints are not there here in this business.
Okay, you mentioned a little bit about challenges related to finances. Could you also tell us a little bit about other challenges that India is facing in terms of the utilization of shale gas?
So shale gas primarily revolves from the fact that it requires lots of water. Lots and lots of water. Just to give a small number, to extract 1 cubic feet, about 3.7 gallons of water is required. Now, to put it in our understanding, it requires almost close to 12 to 13 liters of water to extract 1 cubic feet. And in 2012, US successfully extracted 650 odd million cubic feet, or trillion cubic feet, right? So then you talk about the water availability, and here, because of the technology constraints, so you have 80% of the water that is pumped in to extract the shale gas is being sort of what you call used. So there is no what you call reusability factor there. Whereas 20%, which is ideally called the flowback, which basically oozes out from these wells, and that can be collected, and so far that can be successfully treated and can be fed back into the well. So in that way, I guess 80% is what one has to assume that it is the, what you call, foregone water consumption. Now, clearly the first and biggest challenge is at the water frontier, right? And apart from the consumption, shale gas extraction is also cited to be one of the most premier reason why groundwater resources are being polluted. So what happens is, during the extraction, fine particles of silica sand is mixed with arsenic chemicals or, you know, other hazardous chemicals with water, and they are injected into these wells. And when these injection occurs, I mean, going by the sheer, what do you call, basic understanding of it, there is always going to be that leakages. And these leakages are good enough to go and spoil or pollute the current groundwater resources. And I guess that could be the reason why India was reluctant to right away adopt this technology, because, you know, when water is something that is very, very, very sensitive, almost close to religion in India. And I personally feel that unless and until we sort out our differences when it comes to water allocation, I guess that will be one of the most biggest challenge, especially from the context of availability, let alone reusability.
So going forward, what kind of policy options should India look at?
Yes, one of the, so water and energy nexus has not been delved deeper in Indian context. So several other countries have understood the nexus between energy and water, and most of the policies are structured in a way that one or the other sort of complements each other. So in that way, both these ministries have to work in tandem, and they have to understand their limitations first, and they should accept the limitation. And the second biggest challenge or barrier that I see from the context of policy is the whole notion of where does the social element here place. Now, most of these infrastructural projects that requires lots of space and zones per se are primarily ridden from the fact that the relocation and the rehabilitation program sort of takes the biggest brunt. And I guess that is where I feel the first commitment has to come from the government. These are not like other projects, say, which are primarily focused on dams or focused on roads. India should treat this as a quintessential project, and enough importance should be given to it, because 60 trillion cubic feet can make a difference in our energy mix. However, if you go by the other report, we have 600 trillion cubic feet of potential. And when that is tapped, the next 6 decades of our own natural gas demand is met. Which means you can say, from the context of economical variability, we have enough room around when we keep our base strong. And the base elements clearly are from the context of water and from the context of RAR, which is rehabilitation and relocation. When we sort out before getting into this big time, I guess these two are primarily the biggest challenge for the policymakers to basically address how and when they can work it out so that the privatization occurs and the expansion of market occurs. I guess until then, these kind of small allocations will be and should be supported.
Thank you.